Okay, let's talk in this video cast about race and ethnicity. Now, here are some basic definitions. Race versus ethnicity is a group whose members share a supposed genetic heritage that provides a set physical, biological, and some say mental characteristics. For example, white, black, Asian, etc. An ethnic group or ethnicity is one that shares a common cultural heritage passed on from one generation to the next, for example, being Jewish or Hispanic. There are black Hispanics and white Hispanics in the U.S. and around the world, just as there are Jews who can trace their roots back to Germany and Prussia and Eastern Europe, etc. So in a nutshell, race is a set of biological characteristics. Ethnicity is a set of cultural characteristics. Usually, though, we tend to mix the two either because of political correctness or because we don't know the difference. For example, we tend to overuse the term African-American to describe all Americans who have dark skin, but dark-skinned folks can trace their heritage to Africa, the Caribbean islands, Central and South America, and many people who live in the U.S. who have dark skin are not American by birth, perhaps they're Haitian, Dominican, Cuban, etc. Black is a term that would encompass all such folks, but it's also a term that is seen as being culturally insensitive or simply too general. So that's just something to consider there, some food for thought on the difference between race and ethnicity. Also important, what is a minority? A minority is a group given unequal treatment in society and having unequal power in that society, despite their numerical proportion. Based on some arbitrary characteristic, such as race, sex, or age. For instance, there are 23 million blacks in South Africa, which is about 77% of the population, compared with 7 million whites. But blacks are considered a minority in terms of the power, especially that they had under apartheid. And a final important term, institutional discrimination. This is well-established, organized, and widely accepted acts of denying groups equal access to society's resources and rewards. Obviously, this doesn't just apply to race or ethnicity, and we'll see institutional discrimination come back into the conversation when we talk about sex and gender, sexuality, more about the poor, and so on. Okay, next, what discrimination do immigrants face? Right now, Hispanics living in America face most of this discrimination. It is estimated that two-thirds of illegal immigrants come from Mexico, but make up about 90% of all arrests by the Immigration and Naturalization Service, INS. Ergo, those with Mexican physical features are singled out more often by U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement, for example, in business raids. Those with Nicaraguan features, those with, who appear to come from Central America or South America. Other groups, Cubans, Haitians, Dominicans, tend to immigrate to Florida. Texas's, Arizona's, and New Mexico's immigration problems are largely centered on Mexicans. California's immigrants are largely from Mexico in the southern half of the state and from Asia in the northern half of the state. A great deal of illegal immigrants from Europe still settle in northern cities, Chicago, New York, Boston. Oftentimes, these folks do not sneak in to the country like we tend to hear of Mexicans doing along the southern border. Rather, immigrants from Europe tend to come over as tourists and simply decide to stay, or immigrants will come from different countries on student visas, but get jobs after school and never leave after the visa has expired. Because we currently consider illegal immigration to be a problem with Hispanics, ICE, the Immigration and Customs Enforcement, raids tend to focus on immigrants from Central and South America. Little is done to actively seek out European illegal immigrants unless one specific person or another has committed criminal acts. What is the history of immigration like in the U.S.? The above explains what I just talked about, explains a bit about the current state of immigration in this country, specifically illegal immigration. But right now, Hispanics are simply the illegal du jour, you might say, the illegal problem of the day. Historically, it has not always been this way. Definition time. Emigration, with an E, is the act of leaving one's country for another. Immigration, with an I, is the act of entering another country where one is not a citizen. In other words, people emigrate from Nicaragua, for example, and immigrate to the United States. See the difference? Now, let us consider who came here voluntarily versus involuntarily. Here, how clear-cut is this distinction? Most people usually think of African slaves, but what about Polish and Russian and German Jews fleeing persecution in the 1930s and 40s? Irish fleeing famine in the 19th century? Haitians fleeing dictatorship? There's a lot on the history of immigration, starting with the first few pages of Mashonis' chapter 3. So make sure you check out that part of the text and associated charts and tables. For one reason or another, each of the immigrating groups was pushed by three factors. First, economic, seeking a better life. This applies to all groups we're discussing. Second, political. This applies specifically to the Puritans, Irish, Haitians. And then third, cultural. For example, religious persecution. Again, the Puritans, Indian Muslims, etc. And a search for change in core values. For example, Alexis de Tocqueville in 1835 identified three core values that distinguished American culture from Western European values: equality, freedom, and individualism. Remember, this was 1835. People have historically immigrated to the United States in search of these values. How has the dominant group treated immigrants historically? From the colonial period through the Jacksonian period under President Andrew Jackson, which is 1829 to 37, whites were primarily of English or Anglo ancestry. Anglos marginalized the Germans. They were co-opted for their skills, asked to work for the majority of Anglos for low wages, were viewed as stinky and stupid. Irish and Italians came next. Their Catholic roots put them in the position of not being completely white and were marginalized by the Anglos and the Germans. They too were exploited as workers for low wages. Jews were less than white because of not being Christians, Protestant or Catholic. They were marginalized by Anglos, Germans, Irish, and Italians. Again, this newest group of immigrants was exploited as low-wage workers. By the time we reached the 1800s, Asians were co-opted for their skills. For example, Asians working in mines in the West during the gold and silver strikes, they too were marginalized by the Anglos, the Germans, the Irish, the Italians, and the Jews. By the 20th century, Hispanics became the dominant immigrant group, legal and illegal immigrants. They were given the lowest paying jobs, the jobs that nobody else wanted to do, and they have been marginalized by the Anglos, the Germans, the Irish, the Italians, the Jews, and the Asians. In short, each new immigrant group is marginalized, treated poorly, paid poorly, by the immigrant groups who came here before. Okay? Economic troubles have been blamed on those minority groups, leading to new prejudices. For example, those Latinos in Southern California who leech off of the public schools and hospitals without paying any taxes. And this is actually not true, because the vast majority of Hispanics living in the U.S. are here legally, have a green card and a social security number, and do pay taxes just the same as everybody else. Sidebar, interestingly, every new immigrant group who was seen by those who were already here as either too dumb or too smart. Germans, Irish, Hispanics, all seen as manual laborers with little to offer to intellectual climate. Indians, Koreans, Jews were often seen as too smart, too business-oriented. So the main point: prejudice against immigrants is nothing new. It's just that the newest groups receive most of the blame for economic troubles, for social troubles, and receive the bulk of prejudice against immigrants in general. And though this is characteristic of the U.S., where most everyone is either an immigrant or descends from immigrants, this prejudice is not restricted to the U.S. European nations with religious freedom and strong social support systems, for instance in Scandinavia or Britain, have seen a large influx of immigrants from South Central Asia and the Middle East of late, and there has been a great deal of prejudice against them in these countries. Okay, so to sum it all up, how can we explain racism? First, the primordialist perspective. This is the perspective of hate groups, to put it simply. They say that there are distinct differences between the races that are biological, like lower intelligence among blacks, Jews' primordial need to control business and media, and thus everyone, and so on. Secondly, obviously, the above is not the perspective of sociologists. In sociology, we explain racism as a product of socialization, or the socialization perspective, as opposed to the primordialist perspective. Racism is learned. Socialization is the process by which values and norms are passed on from one generation to the next. Psychologists have found that children differentiate between the races as early as 3 years old, and they can make evaluations of people of different races by age 4 or 5. Usually, children repeat what is said by their parents with total conviction but without understanding what they're saying until much later in life when the prejudices are set. Yes, prejudices can change, but the older one gets, the harder it is to change. How can we counteract racism? From the socialization perspective, via education. We have two options. First, the multicultural or pluralist approach. It's big in education these days. The idea is that all cultures have something worthy to contribute, and we should learn to listen and appreciate, or at least respect our differences. The other approach is the assimilation approach. The idea here is that ethnic minorities, remember, those with less power, should learn to meet the expectations of the dominant culture. For example, acquire the social and cultural capital necessary to fit in. We'll talk more about these when we get to this week's discussion and readings, so I hope you've learned some valuable information here, and with that, I'll see you online.